So once again, we are back after a very long time. Actually, in the last class with regards to introduction to computer science, we actually dealt with if else statement, while statement as well. So even we went with the do while statement as well. So this particular class, we'll go with nested loops, which is nothing but loop within another loop. Okay. And then we would go with the break as well as continue statements. So this is especially for you, my dear young researchers and students. And you can reach me at dr.krishnaanand@gmail.com. So before beginning the session, let me thank God for giving me this golden opportunity to deliver this useful session. To share my knowledge among my fellow national and international participants. Actually, there is a special reason why I would like to thank God today, very specially because we were experiencing car failure right now. So I was literally thinking how I would be able to handle the session. So at that time, at the last moment, the power came and I was able to charge my laptop and I was able to deliver the talk. So this particular class, we would discuss more about nesting loops, which is nothing but loop within another loop, and then selection with if-else statement, and then there would be a sample program, and then I would discuss its output also, and then with the case of the if-else statement as well as the nested if-else statement, we would have a short discussion, and then we would discuss more about the jump state with the case of the break or maybe continue or maybe go to. And then we would discuss about a sample program which contains the break statement. And then we would discuss about go to statement and labels. And then there would be sample exercises where you can really work it out. And then I think you would have gone through the assignments or maybe the independent works in the Google Classroom. So I would like to take this class as an initiative to make sure that all the students have joined in the Google Classroom and have seen the independent works posted in the Google Classroom. And then I would be giving some independent works today also, and there would be short videos to explain more about the discussion, and there would be a short class test as well. So with regards to nesting loops, you can literally say the meaning of nesting loops is that loop can be contained in another loop. Okay, so a loop body can also contain a loop. So you have the American National Standard Institute ANSI, which stipulates a maximum depth of 256 nested loops. Okay, have as many loops as you want, but only thing you sh it should have a condition, it should have a syntax, it should have a role, and it should have a quote as well, so as to particularly picturize the output. The program on the opposite page, maybe I would show you the simple program where it would contain like two loops. One would be nested within the other. Okay. Every time when the outer do-while loop is repeated, then there would be a short break. Okay. So actually, the short break is actually it's actually based on the inner for loop. So which is going to create a break in the outer do-while loop. So I'll be explaining you with the help of a program. The outside you have a do-while loop and inside you have a for loop. So this inner for loop is going to create a break for the outer do-while loop. Okay. We have two characters, two variables, text and output. Generally, the output you'll have a variable called output. Okay. So the tone is generated by outputting the control character bit, which is having the ASCII code of 7. Represented by the escape sequence. So I'll show you a simple program later onwards. So this was the program that was trying to talking about. So with the case of selection with if-else statement, this is the structure of or maybe the syntax. We have if expression. Either it may be true or it may be false. If there is an expression and if it is said to be true, then statement one is executed. And if there is an expression and if it is false, then statement 2 will be executed. So this is how the if-else statement is going to function. this was a sample program where you use a if else statement. Hash include IO string, so using namespace std function, int main function, and then you define three variables x, y, and min. Okay, so x, y, and min are said to be floating point variables. Okay, so the output you are going to output as c out, enter two different numbers. So you are giving a condition if c in is greater than x, or maybe and, okay, and. So you are also including expression and c in is greater than y. So in this case, so if both the inputs are valid, then compute the lesser. So the program is all about computing the lesser number. Okay. So if x less than y, so what you are going to do? Min equal to x. Okay. Is min equal to y. So you are giving with one if expression. If expression, then statement 1, this is statement 1, min equal to x, else statement 2, min equal to y. Okay, and then you are going to print out c out is less than new line character, the smaller number is. So what you are going to print, the smaller number is either it can be x or it can be y. If x is less than y, then minimum is equal to x, or y is the minimum. Okay, so and then after this brace, you are going to end, okay, because this one you have one if else, and this one you have another if else. Okay, this is if and this is else. See out invalid input. So you are giving two numbers. If the input is valid, then it is going into inner if else statement. Else it is going to print invalid input. So if the numbers are valid, then it is going to inner if else statement, and it is going to see and it is going to check whether x is less than y. So in this case, minimum equal to x, else minimum equal to y. Okay, and then finally return 0, or maybe return null, or maybe return void state. So this is how you are going to print this program. So your numbers, maybe you can give 1 and 2, or maybe 3 and 4, or you can give floating point numbers also, because you have defined the variables x, y, and minimum to be floating type. Okay, so you can give a decimal value. Okay, so enter two different numbers, 7.5 and 5.7. okay, so the smaller number is, whether it is 7.5 or 5.7, it is 5.7. So this was what I was talking about. So the if else statement can be used to choose between two conditional statements. Okay, so if expression, then statement 1 would be executed, else statement 2 is executed. Okay. So when the program is being run, expression is evaluated and the program control branches accordingly. If the result is said to be true, then statement 1 is executed, or otherwise statement 2 is executed. And this is a nested if else statement. Actually, we already discussed with the help of a program. Okay. So if n is greater than 0, okay, and then if n percentage true equal to 1, okay, which means that the what is the meaning of n percentage true? What is the meaning of n percentage true? What is the meaning of this percentage symbol?
It gets the remainder when n divided by 2.
Very good, very good. So when it gets a remainder when it is divided by 2. Okay, so when it is equal to 1, it is said to be positive odd number. For example, if you have 7 by 2, okay, 7 by 2, definitely your remainder would be equal to 1. Okay, so it's generally a positive odd number. Okay, or else you can give as else C out is given by positive even number. Okay, for example, 22 divided by 4. Okay, so the remainder is actually 2. So it's a positive even number. So in this way, you can check with the case of a multiple if else statement. So outside you have a if else statement, and then inner you have a if else statement. Thank you.
Right.
So this is the case. Generally, in this example, the else branch belongs to the second. So you can have like a, if n greater than 0. So this is one if condition, and then within the brace you are including another if statement. If n percentage true equal to 1 in C out positive odd number, then you are going to go for else C out negative number or 0. Okay. So in this case, what it does is if n greater than 0, for example, it can be 3. Okay. Then 3% true is definitely equal to 1. So it would be printing positive odd number. Okay. Else, what you are going to do is if, for example, you are giving minus 5, minus 7, minus 9, then it is going to print as negative number, or maybe other condition is if you give n is equal to 0 also, it would be printing this way. So it is either a negative number or it is 0. So either numbers which is greater than 0, it is going to print positive odd number. Either numbers which is equal to 0 or maybe less than 0, it is going to print as negative number or 0. Yes, was there any discussion? So the next thing we are going to go with the jumps with the break statement, continue, and then go to statement. So that is a special case of this jump statement, okay, with the case of the break. So it is nothing but the structurogram for a break within a while statement. Okay, so as long as the expression is true, you are going to break it, okay, and then you are going to go with the statement which follows through. Okay, so when the expression is true, you are going to break it. So if the expression is false, you are going to go with the loop. So that's the thing. Okay, so this is the break within a while statement. Okay. So what we are going to do, we are going to output an ASCII code table. So this is a simple example where you try to output an ASCII code table. You have hash include IO stream, hash include IO manipulation. So you are going to access the manipulation file, okay, using namespace yesterday function int main function. Okay. Then what you are going to do, you are going to input an integer AC. So this stands for ASCII code 32, okay, without the control character. So int AC equal to 32. Now what you are going to do, you are going to do a while statement. Okay. So within the while statement, when it is said to be true, you are going to start the brace C out character decimal hexadecimal. Okay, so you are going to go with the upper value as integer int upper, and then for upper equal to AC plus 20. Okay, so this AC actually lies within the range maybe upper, and then from upper to 256. Okay, then what you are going to do, you are going to output the C out value, which is character of C, okay, char of AC, okay, and you are going to set the bit. With the case of decimal, generally it lies within AC, and then with the case of hexadecimal, set width of 10, it is going within AC, okay. Now what you are going to do, you are going to include this condition, okay. So within the while statement, you are going to go with the for statement, and then you have a if statement. Okay, so if upper greater than equal to 256. Okay, so what you are going to do, you are going to break it. So you are going to return, or maybe you are going to stop it, and then you are going to go with a char answer. Okay, you are going to get the you know, the input answer value, and you are going to equate it to q. Okay, and after this one, when this condition if statement is said to be true, you are going to go with the break statement. Okay. So this is how we are going to output a ASCII code table. So what you are going to do is, you are going to define a new variable AC, okay, equal to 32, because it's a ASCII code without control characters. Now you are going to start the loop while of true, and then you are going to go with a printing character decimal and then hexadecimal. You are going to define an upper variable int, and you are going to stay within the limits upper equal to AC plus 20, which is less than 256. And then next what you are going to do, you are going to set the width. Okay. Next what you are going to do, then you are going to go with the if statement upper greater than equal to 256, you are going to break it. If as long as it is less than 256, it is okay, we are going to print the value. But if it is greater than equal to 256, we are going to go with the stop. Okay. Then sharp answer, and then you are going to equate answer equal to q, or maybe answer equal to capital Q, then you are going to break it. Okay. So this is how you are going to go with the this is actually a nested loop where you have used a while statement at the outside, and inside you have a for and then if statement as well, and then finally return zero.
Good job.
Yes. Do you have any doubts?
Yes.
Yes, tell me. Yes, do you have any doubts? Do you have any clarifications?
No, no questions.
Okay.
It's understandable. Okay. Right.
So we are going to continue with the case of the break statement. So we have already discussed whenever a condition is said to be true. So what we are going to do, we are going to break it out. So it is going to exit out from a switch or maybe a loop immediately. What you are going to do, you are going to include a keyword called break to jump to the first statement that follows the switch or the loop. Okay. So here we would see a case where generally, if it is less than 256, it's okay. So if it is greater than 256, then you are going to break or maybe terminate counter thread. So this is an example of a continuous statement. Generally, it is used in loops. So in the case of a while or maybe do-while loop, generally the program jumps to the test expression. So this is what an example. We have for int I equal to 0. So we are defining an integer. I equal to 0, so I less than 100, I plus plus. Okay, so within the brace you have if I percentage 2 equal to 1. Okay, now we are going to go with a continuous statement. Okay, and then you are going to end the brace. So what you are going to do is, so you are going to define I equal to 0 and I less than 100, I plus plus. So it's going to increment up to 99 value. Okay, so if I percentage 2 equal to 1, so it is going to continue. Okay, right. So this is how it's going to break it up. So with the case of the break statement as well as with the case of the continuous statement. So break statement means it is going to terminate out of the loop, and continuous statement means it is going to continue with the case of the remaining integer values. This is an example of a go-to statement and then the labels. Okay, so go-to statement means when you're going to go with the go-to, then it is going to jump to any given point which is marked by the label within the function. You can exit from a deeply embedded loop instruction by using this go to on a B label system. For example, if you have a syntax for expression and then for expression, if error, then immediately it is going to jump it out to the error check. Okay, so it is going to go to error check. Okay, so error check is nothing but the error handling. Okay, so this is how you are going to terminate out of the loop. So it is going to immediately jump to the error check. Okay, so a label is nothing but a name followed with a colon. So here we have error check colon. Okay, so labels can proceed any statement. A program can do without a go to statement as well. So if you need to use the go to statement, then definitely you can do so to exit from the code block to avoid entering code blocks by this method. So this is how you are going to terminate out of the loop in all of a sudden, and you are going to go with the label. So I will say colon. So something which follows colon definitely is said to be a label. So these are sample exercises. This is a particular class. I am more interested to discuss with you some sample exercises. So this is one particular exercise. Okay. So the question is, write a C++ program that outputs a complete multiplication table. Okay. So you have a multiplication table 1 to 10. Okay. For example, with the case of 1. So it is 1, 2, 3 up to 10. With the case of 2, it is 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 up to 20. With the case of 3, 3, 6, 9, 12 up to 30. 4, 8, 12, 16 up to 40. So in the same case, 10, 20, 30, 40 up to 100. So this particular multiplication table, we are going to print it with the help of a C++ program. So let's discuss more about this sample exercise. So many of us would have known about it, but still, in order to refresh the basics, we are going to go with this case. So multi-table, that's APP. Actually, we are going to go with the output of the multiplication table. That's what discussed in the comments section. Hash include IO stream, hash include IO manipulation. So something which involves like functions with the addition, subtraction, multiplication as well. We are going to go with IO manipulation. And then using namespace std in main function. Now what you are going to do, you are going to include two variables, factor 1 and factor 2. They are set to be integers. Okay. So in the case of cout, what you are going to do, slash n slash new line character multiplication table. Because in the first case we say multiplication table on the first line. So it should be a new line statement. Okay. And then with the case multiplication table n1. What first what you are going to do is you are going to output the first and second line. Okay. So C out slash in slash in slash in. So the this is actually the first line. Okay. And then with the case of the for loop, the outer for loop, factor 2 equal to what? Factor 2 less than or equal to 10 plus plus factor. So you are going to initialize the factor equal to 1 as long as it's less than 10, because this one after 10 it is going to print, but this one actually less than or equal to 10, so it is going to print up to 10, 1, 2, 3, 4 up to 10 and plus plus factor 2. Okay, so with the case of cout, you are going to set the width, okay, with a 5 less than factor 2. Okay, and then what you are going to do, you are going to print the second line, cout slash in second line, you are going to end 1. Okay, then with the case of the remaining lines of the table, for factor 1 equal to 1, factor 1 less than or equal to 10, plus plus factor 1. Okay. Now within the loop, you are going to print the C out set width of 6, factor 1. For factor 2 equal to 1, factor 2 less than or equal to 10, plus plus factor 2. You are going to set the width 5. So factor 1 into factor 2. So what you are going to do is this is factor 1 and this is factor 2. You are going to do 1 into 1. Okay, so this is what you're going to do. This with the case of the first one, 1 into 1. Okay, and with the case of the second one, it is 2 into factor 2. Okay, 3 into factor 3, 4 into factor 4. So this is how you're going to go with this case. Okay, so this is actually 1 into 2, 1 into 3. Okay, 2 into 2, 2 into 3, 2 into 4, 2 into 5. Okay, the same case, 3 into 1, 3 into 2. 3 into 3, 3 into 4, 3 into 5. So this is factor 1 and this is actually factor 2. Okay. So you are going to set the width 5 less than factor 1 into factor 2, C out N1, and then with the outer case C out slash in, you are going to shift it up to the table, return 0. I hope everybody understood this program. With the case of the factor 1 and factor 2, first what you are going to do, you are going to print the first line, multiplication table. And with the factor 2 and factor 1, you are going to define the limits. Factor 2 equal to 1, factor 2 less than or equal to 10, plus plus factor 2. So what you are going to do, 1, 2 up to 10. Okay. And with the case of the second case, you are going to go with factor 1, less than or equal to 10, factor plus plus. So this vertical type, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4 up to 10. Okay. So within the loop, what you have to do, factor 2 equal to 1, factor 2 less than or equal to 10, plus plus factor 2. And then what you are going to do, you are going to set the width of out of 5 with factor 1 into factor 2. So with this particular table, this particular case, what you are going to do is 1 into 1, 1 into 2, 1 into 3, 1 into 4. 1 into 5. Okay, so next what you do, 2 into 1, 2 into 2, 2 into 3, 2 into 4, 2 into 5. So this is how you are going to multiply the two factors. And then you are going to go with the outer loop, C out, less than, slash in, slash in, slash in, and then you are going to return with a 0 or void string. And then there is another sample exercise. Write a C++ program that reads an integer between 0 and 65535 from the keyboard and use it to save a random number generator. Then output 20 random numbers between 1 and 100. Okay. So it's the program is going to read the integers between 0 and 65,535, and then with the it is going to print 20 random numbers between 1 to 100. So this is a random C++ program. So it's going to output 20 random numbers from 1 to 100. So hash include stdlib.h, hash include iostring. So because we are going to include the random variables, that's the reason we include standard library function. And then because we are involving some arithmetic or maybe logic functions, we are including IO manipulation library using namespace std function int main. And then we are going to define unsigned integer value, unsigned integer I and then c. Okay. So with the case of the C out statement, please type an integer between 0 and 65,535. You are going to input the value. Okay. So if C input greater than C, so it's going to read the integer. Okay. And then it is going to give a random value. Yes, random. So this is nothing but seeding the random number generator. So yes, random of C. Okay. And then with the case of C out, you are going to print out random numbers. Okay. So for I equal to 1, I less than or equal to 20, I plus plus I. So this is actually, it's going to print 20 random numbers. So that's the reason I less than or equal to 20. It is going to pre-increment by plus plus I. Okay, C out, set width of 20, I random number equal to, okay. And then set width of 3, random value, percentage 100 plus 1. So this is going to print some 20 random numbers. So that's the reason you are going to go with percentage 100 plus 1 and then return 0. So definitely it would be printing 20 random numbers between 0 to 100. Yes. Yes, hello, sir. Is there something to discuss? So this is another program where we have a sample exercise. This is actually a game. Okay, a computer stores a random number between 1 to 15 and the player attempts to guess it. Okay, read this program very carefully. This is a case. Okay, the computer stores a random number between 1 to 15. Okay, and the player attempts to guess it. The player has a total of 3 attempts. After each wrong guess, the computer tells the user if the number was too high or too low. Okay. If the third attempt is also wrong, the number is output on the screen. Okay. The player wins if he or she can guess the number within 3 attempts. For example, the computer stores a random number between 1 to 15. For example, let us take in the case, it is 5. Okay. Now the player makes the first attempt, maybe 11. Okay. So this is a wrong guess. Okay. So the number is actually 5. So the player 1 has attempted the first attempt, it is 11. Okay. So the computer says the number is quite far from the value. Okay. Okay. So he makes the second attempt. Okay. Maybe like 3. Okay. And after that, the computer says the number is close to the number. Okay. And the third attempt, for example, the player makes says 5. Okay, so 5, that's the correct answer. So he or she wins the game. So this is the logic of this program. So this is actually a numerical game against a computer. Hash include CSTD library. So we are, because we are going to include the prototypes, SRAM. And then hash include C type, because we are including the 3 atoms. So that's the reason we are including a prototype of time function. Hash include iostream using namespace std int main function. You are going to go with 2 variables, int number and then attempt. Okay. And then you are going to include a character variable wb which is equal to r. This is actually repeat or maybe finish. Okay. And then log second. Okay. Time ampersand second. So you are going to get the time in second. And then this random value you are going to define it as unsigned integer second. Okay. C out a numerical game. Okay, and then see out rules of the game is as follows. While wb the character equal to r, what you are going to do, you are going to make the 3 attempts. So you are going to repeat it. I have a number between 1 and 15 in mind. You have 3 chances to guess it correctly. Okay, and then you are going to add one number equal to random percentage 15, okay, plus 1. Okay, so with this case, with every false attempt you are making, boolean found equal to false, int count equal to 0. Okay, so what you are going to do is while found and count less than 3. Okay, so with this case, you are going to get the CIN sync value. You are going to clear the input buffer. Okay, so what you are going to do, you are going to increment the attempt by C out, count. What you are going to do is, you are, if the player makes a first attempt, okay, then what it will do, it will maybe the clear the input buffer, maybe the first attempt is already over, so it is going to increment it. Okay, it is going to increment the count. Okay, and if attempt is less than number, okay, maybe if it is too small, so it's going to say too small, or maybe attempt is greater than number, it is says too big. For example, if the number is 5, okay, and if the player makes a guess of 11, it is going to say too big. Okay, suppose if the number is actually 5 and maybe the player has guessed maybe 3, maybe something near to that, you can say okay, just right, okay, something like that. Okay, else found equal to 2. Okay, only if this case, if the value equal to 5, it is going to say it is a correct value. Okay, so if not found, then seek out I'm 1. Okay, the number in the question was, else what you are going to do, you are going to say congratulations, you won. Okay, right, so you are going to say, it's going to say the computer says I won, and the number in the question was actually 5. Else if the player has made the correct attempt, then it is going to say congratulations, you won, and you are going to repeat it. Okay, repeat and maybe finish it. Okay, and then in the case of while, WP not equal to R and WP not equal to F, we are going to end up with a return 0 state. Once again, I am going to discuss this program with the case of the the number and atom. First of all, you are going to define two variables, number and atom. Okay, character WP equal to R. You are going to define the time as the long time seconds, and then ampersand second. We are going to define an unsigned maybe a random variable srand unsigned second, a numerical game, and the rules of the game. Okay, I have a number between 1 and 15 and my. You have 3 chances to guess correctly. What you are going to do, you are going to give the random number percentage 15 plus 1. So this one, it's going to give 3 atoms. Okay, you are going to give with the 3 random numbers, boolean found equal to false, int count equal to 0. So either with the case of the false value, so it's going to increase the atom, second atom, third atom, and after the third atom, it is going to break it out. Okay, so while not found, and ampersand count less than 3, so it is go with the C out plus plus count. Okay, so every time the attempt is being incremented, so if it is less than number, so it is going to say too small. If the attempt is greater than number, it is going to say too big. Okay, so for example, else found equal to true, then it is going to break the entire loop. Okay, and it would say congratulations, you won. For example, if it is either too small or too big, it is going to continue, and after three attempts, it is going to say I won. The number in the question was 5. Okay, so this is how you are going to go with the program in computer numerical. I'm posting the independent work. I'm posting this in the chat window.